Let's take a look at the obesity trends occurring in 195 countries and see what we can learn. So this was a fascinating study, came out in 2017, that looked at the trends in obesity across 25 years worth of data in over 195 countries. And it was very simple. What they wanted to see was what's going on in terms of death and disability related to simply being overweight in these 195 countries. And the data was collected from 1990 to 2015. All right, so when we look at worldwide obesity rates in 2015, we find a few fascinating things. First, 5% of the children, 107.7 million children, are considered to be obese. Now, in the adults, it's over almost half a billion. And women tend to be a lot more in the obese category than men are. In terms of peaks, women and men actually peak at different times. Men, you will see the peak of their obesity around 50 to 54, but for women, it's almost a decade later. And the children, the sad part of children is as they get older, up until age 14, even though there's a decline in obesity, after the age of 14, there's a steady increase that goes well into adulthood. Now, one of the data points in this particular study, the SDI or Socio-Demographic Index, the note is SDI is just an average of income per capita, the education of people, and the total fertility rate. Now, it's a great way of basically being able to look at countries that have sort of more development than other countries do. So higher income countries generally have a higher SDI. So what does SDI tell us? Well, if you look at age groups, you'll find that the orange dashed line, which is the highest SDI group, actually tends to have the highest obesity. Now, the poorest country, which is the red line below, as a comparison shows you what a stark difference there is. And that should come as no surprise, because as companies become more and more industrialized, they start to shift away from things like whole foods, focusing on plants, into more processed foods and more processed meats and fast foods. And that generally tends to be one part of the problem, not all of it. Now, same exact thing with looking at year after year from 1980 to 2015, we find the same exact trend. Higher income countries, which is the orange dashed line, tend to have higher prevalence of obesity, and that rate has continued to increase over the last 25 years. Obesity in children, very similar pattern. Once again, higher socio-demographic index, higher the amount of obesity that's found in those countries. Now, if you look at the entire United States and then you look at the world, what we find is in terms of the prevalence of obesity, we actually stand out in the United States as having some of the highest prevalence, which means how many people in the United States have obesity right now. When you look at children, and this is all from 2015. So when you look at children, unfortunately, we also lead the world when it comes to obesity prevalence. But what's fascinating is what if we switch gears and look at disability or chronic conditions or chronic illnesses related to simply BMI or excess weight? What we find is surprising. In this one, what I want you to notice is from 1990 and 2015, look at the purple. The purple is actually chronic kidney disease. Now, kidney disease is one of those diseases that's seldom talked about, but it is so important. And it has such an economic, physical, emotional toll on people that it really needs to be brought to attention more often. If we look at death instead of disability, we find the same thing, that between 1990 and 2015, the death rate due to kidney disease has significantly increased. And same thing with diabetes. You look at the comorbidities and now you look at the death rate from diabetes, that's also increased. So what's the really bottom line here that you can take away? Well, first, excess BMI accounted for 4 million deaths in 2015. And what's fascinating about that and so incredibly sad is 70% of those deaths are due to cardiovascular disease, which we have so many good treatments, but we know that lifestyle makes such a tremendous impact on lowering the risk for heart disease. And in terms of disability, if you look at disability life years, there's 120 million disability adjusted life years. That's a huge amount that people are suffering, and those sufferings that are occurring can be lowered, reduced, and prevented through things like taking better care of ourselves. So when you look at health risk and all of the different things, you find that BMI has some of the highest increase in rates in those health risks going on. So the major drivers of these changes are simple. First, the food environment, the food systems have all changed, and they're pushing towards trying to make things faster, cheaper, and more available. And as a result of it, cheap foods that are readily available, although they're filling and they're calorie dense, they tend to be very nutritionally poor. The other stuff is that there's intense marketing for cheaper quality foods, and there's not the same kind of marketing for quality foods such as fruits and vegetables. And then even with exercise, going to the gym is difficult for some people. There's a financial investment that some people can't make. So now with all of the urbanization, there's actually less safe spaces to walk. There's less parks, and that also has an impact, although that's a smaller driver when you look at all of the previous drivers. Now the take-home message between this study is simple. What they found is that the minimum risk level or the safest BMI really is around 20 to 25. That's body mass index, which is weight and height taken into consideration. Now always when we look at studies, we want to talk about limitations. The limitations here were its self-reported data. The BMI is not as good as an indicator as we like. Waist to hip ratios would be better, but they're very difficult to do, so they're a little bit harder. There could be difference in ethnic groups far more so than just countries, and those unfortunately weren't captured, and there are always other confounders. And of course, this wasn't designed to study causation. So bottom line is simple. Obesity and the disease burden associated with obesity are increasing. And there's no such thing as a quick fix to this epidemic. It's going to take all hands on deck, a multifactorial, multi-component intervention to address this. So this goes along with all of the stuff that we've talked about previously, which is if you eat whole foods, mostly plants, you will find that you're able to obtain health. And if you continue with the self principle of sleeping 7 to 9 hours, moving more, creating lasting relationship, practicing gratitude and mindfulness, and of course, eating mostly plants, you will give yourself the best edge to live a full, healthy life. Thanks so much for watching, and don't forget to share, subscribe, and like on social media, and we'll see you next time.